Welcome, friends, once again to the second day of our three-day program in London. I am again happy to see all of you and to share more information about the path of the masters, the Sant Math, which is path of saints, so that we can all take advantage of the teachings these mystics and masters have left for us, and also get guidance from a perfect living master who is living right now. I mentioned yesterday the importance of starting our spiritual journey at the right place, which is in the head behind the eyes. If we start our journey anywhere else, we will not be going in the right direction nor in the right place. So it's very important that we start our journey right behind the eyes, in the head, by treating this body of ours as a house, as a building, as a place we live in. And this has several floors. The sixth floor is behind the eyes, and we want to go and start our journey from there. Today I want to mention to you something very, very important if you want to go beyond the mind. If you want to go and have nice views of the inner worlds, the astral world, the world of sense perceptions, the world where all heavens and hells are, the world where you can experience anything through your imagination, the world where imagination becomes a reality, you don't have to go too far. It's only one step away. You withdraw your attention from this body and you go in and you will reach that stage. But if you want to go beyond, into the causal region, where you can read how karma is created, how your destinies are all pre-packed, pre-packaged like DVDs, how you pick up a DVD and play it out and that becomes your life. If you want to see that, then you have to go further. And there are a few masters available in this world who can take you there, because they take you beyond heavens and they take you to the causal region, which contains the cause of all things that have ever happened within our knowledge, ever happened within what the mind can contemplate or the senses can perceive. All that is being created in the causal region, and you can have an actual experience of that. But if you want to go to your true home, your Sachkhand, where you belong, where the Atma, the soul belongs, then you have to go beyond the mind. And to go beyond the mind, there is a special means of doing so. I mentioned that the meditation as we know it does not take us there. Meditation is a mental exercise. The best of meditation is a mental exercise. But love and devotion that go beyond meditation take you to that area beyond the causal plane. Because love emanates from our true home and not from the mind, not even from the universal mind. So that is why love can pull you from there. If your beloved is here, the one from whom love flows to you and whose unconditional love you can experience, he can take you beyond the mind. Now today I want to tell you a link that exists between ourself here and our true home and is never broken. That link which connects us at all times to our true home and which gives us life at every level, including physical life, including astral life, causal life. All the life that we have, the experiences we have, consciousness that we have, is continuously linked by one power, one wonderful power. And we don't know how to describe it. Nobody has ever found any language to describe that power, because that power creates the power itself. And we have used different words to describe that power, just because there are no words. Sometimes, just for lack of a word, we call it the word, capital word. In the beginning was the word. We call it the sound. That all things, the Rig Veda says, were made from the nad, the sound. We talk of the music of the spheres. That is sustained, the whole experience is being sustained by the music of the spheres. All these different words we use are trying to describe something which is the very basic creative power, even beyond consciousness. It creates consciousness. It creates God. It creates everything. And this is an amazing power that remains with us continuously without break, no matter what experience you have. When you go to sleep, you are unaware of your body, but you are still aware of yourself. When you move about in a dream, your body is lying in bed. Physical body is lying in bed. You are moving around in a dream. And yet the one who is moving around is the same self that is sleeping. When you wake up, you cannot say that was somebody else that was moving around. It's the same self. The self never changes, because the self is made up of that power which is continuously linked. You go to a higher level of consciousness, your form changes, everything changes, you even become formless, yet the self remains the same. I have often mentioned this story of a Chinese philosopher, Fahin. Fahin had a dream in which he felt he was a butterfly. And he was flying in the garden and going from flower to flower. Those flowers were so beautiful. There was light coming out of those flowers. He had never seen that kind of flower in his life here. And he felt this was more real than anything he had ever seen. But he was a butterfly. He was not a human being. So when he woke up, he said, what kind of dream was it? It looks like that dream was more real than this world. But in the dream, I was a butterfly. I am not sure now, he said. Am I Fahin, the philosopher who had a dream that I was a butterfly? Or am I really a butterfly, now having a dream that I am Fahin, the philosopher? So he told his friends, I had a strange dream in which I was a butterfly. And the friend said, that's impossible, because butterfly is so different from you. How could you think that you could be a butterfly? You should say, in the dream, you saw a butterfly. He said, I never saw a butterfly. I saw the garden. I saw the flowers. I was a butterfly. I never saw myself. I had the eyes of the butterfly. And therefore, how could he still be the same Fahin in the form of a butterfly, where the form has completely changed? What has not changed is the persistence of the self, that is the same self that was a butterfly and the same self that was Fahin. In a dream, no matter what form you take, is the same self. You go to the highest levels of experiences, everything can change, the whole world can change. You can go into higher levels of consciousness, the self will never change. You will always know it's the same self who was in the body, the same self who had a dream, the same self who has gone to higher levels, the same self as in totality. Self never changes. What is sustaining the self? What is making the self unchangeable, no matter what the experience around it is? What makes the experiencer completely permanent, immortal, no change at any time? What is that which is making it so powerful? Is the same power which we call the word, we call the shabd, we call the nad. It is said, shabd creates the shabd. Shabde dharti, shabde akash, shabde shabad bhaya prakash. That shabd created the whole universe we see, but shabd has also created itself. Then this kind of a power can't be explained. Then how do we reach that power? How do we know about it? How can one talk about it? The reason why we can talk about it, the reason why we can use words like shabd, words like word, words like music, words like inner music, celestial music, the reason for using these words is, at the physical state where we are sitting in the physical body, that shabd, that power, that creative power can be heard. It's audible. It's an audible sound. And that is why we can call it with these words. Then that is why we can use this language. So that power, which is can be heard within us, emanates from the self, comes from the self. When we meditate and put our attention behind the eyes, like I was talking yesterday, how we can do it, a little concentration of attention where you can partially withdraw your attention from the body makes you hear the sound inside. It enables you to hear the sound of your own self. And the self, if there was no creation, the only existence of the self will be in that form. So you are able to hear your own self. Now, what is the advantage of hearing your own self? The advantage is that then the self pulls you to itself. Instead of your trying to go somewhere, instead of trying to meditate to achieve something, you are pulled by the very nature of yourself with the advantage that the self is emitting music or a sound which you can hear. So listening becomes a very important part of our meditation. Listening is the most important part of meditation. When they say that you should repeat words of Simran or mantra, then you say you should. It is not the speaking that will take you anywhere. It's the listening to what you are speaking that takes you there. Even then it's listening, not speaking. If you speak and don't listen to something else, nothing will happen. It's only when you listen to the words you are repeating, it has any significance and meaning. Why is that? Because in our anatomy of consciousness, in the way consciousness is built into our system, the soul that is our true reality, is always a listener. And this mind is a speaker. Remember that. At all times, every time you listen to something, your soul is listening. Every time you speak anything, whether in the head or outside, your mind is speaking. Mind is the speaker, soul is the listener. A good combination. Therefore, soul never speaks. It's not necessary. If it has to say something, it uses the mind to speak. It does not use any language. It is beyond language. The soul's communication is beyond language. It uses the mind to create languages and speak in language. So when you are meditating and you want to reach your own self, then you listen. And the one who is listening is yourself. That makes it very simple to understand who are we then. Since our mind and our soul are so interlinked, joined together in such a bond that we can't even separate it. And we continuously believe that it is the soul that is thinking, is the soul that is talking, the soul is expressing its living state. But that's the mind, continuously. The soul is empowering the mind to do it. The soul is making the mind alive. The soul is making the body alive. The soul is making our sense perceptions alive. It's the life force that empowers all these, makes them alive. But it does not participate in any of these things. It listens and it sees. It can see and can listen. The listening power we call surat, and the seeing power we call nirat. Nirat and surat belong to the soul. The speaking is all left to the mind. The collection of data through sense perceptions is all left to the covers upon the mind and upon the soul. But the soul itself is listening and seeing at all times. So that's a good way to know who we are really, that we should not mix up our things with anything that we are seeing as an object. The soul is the one that is seeing and listening at all times. So when we start our meditation, we can make headway by repeating mantras to locate ourselves inside. That's all. The main idea of doing meditation is to pull our attention within ourselves in the head. Once we are able to do that, the next step, which is the more important step, is to listen to the sound coming from the self. When we try to do that, there are many other sounds that come also. There are sounds that come from the body, there are sounds that come from outside, there are sounds that come just from biological operation of this body. There are sounds which we can, if you are concentrating your attention, can be heard even from the flow of the blood. You can hear your heartbeat, you can hear your pulse beat, you can hear your breathing. There are so many sounds that are distracting and can cause you to divert your attention. But the sound that ultimately picks you up, the sound that pulls you to the self, comes from the self, comes from the center of where you belong, comes from the center behind the eyes. In the wakeful state, we are behind the eyes, and that's where the sound comes from, and we can listen to it. When we listen to it, we are pulled by it. What is the nature of that sound? The sound is like sound, that's why we call it sound. It is like a sound that we can hear outside. There's little difference. It has been said that it resembles the bell sound. That is why bells are rung in the temples, the bells are in the belfries in the churches, and bells have been used all over to represent that sound, because it has a resemblance to the bell sound. It is not exactly like a bell sound, because when we ring a bell, we hit the bell, and there's a dong, and then we see there's a hit, and then there's the mellow of the peal of the bell that goes on afterwards. The inner sound does not have that hit. It is just the peal. It has a rhythm. It has like the sine curve up and down, but it does not have that beat, so it's very melodious. It's extremely melodious and beautiful sound that comes from ourselves, from our soul, right within ourselves. If we can catch that sound and just listen to it, that sound can pull us all the way back. All the scenes may change outside. Levels of consciousness may change outside. The sound is a continuous sound right up to our true home, Sachkhand. That is why this particular kind of union with your own totality, yoga, ultimate yoga, is called the Surth Shabd Yoga. The Surth Shabd Yoga meaning the Surth, or your attention of listening, the attention that can listen is Surth. Shabd is the sound that comes from within. Yoga means union with your totality. So the Surth Shabd Yoga, according to my experience and experience of many other people, is the fastest and simplest way to find out your true home. Other methods, I have tried many methods personally. For 8 years I was trying many methods. And they do take you to various levels of experiences. But we get so trapped in those experiences that we begin to think the unusual experience is the reality. We forget entirely about ourselves. But when you want to discover who you are, your own self, then experience is not so important. The experiencer is important. And to reach the experiencer, the best way is to hear the inner sound from yourself and follow it. The other advantage is the sound has a pull towards it, because your own sound, it's your own self. Therefore, it pulls you by itself, and that can be felt when you do meditation and reach that stage where you can hear the sound. When the true sound can be heard, you are swept off your feet, literally. The way the body is vacated of its awareness is so fast through the sound, you can never achieve that merely by repeating words and trying to concentrate your attention at the end. So that is why I am now encouraging you that apart from trying to stabilize yourself behind the eyes through meditation, you should also see what the next step is to hear that sound which connects you with all this. The sound that we are talking of does not remain a sound, because we are used to a physical sound which requires air, which requires the atmosphere that we have here. In vacuum, you can't even hear the sound, even in the physical world. So that sound that comes appears like sound to start with. It changes as we gradually move closer to it and have new experiences inside. Eventually, it just becomes a power. And the power which has a resonance in the early stages looks like a vibration, looks like a frequency of something moving. But then it becomes totally a creative power. Ultimately, it becomes your own self. So this is an easy, best way to travel on the spiritual path to your own true identity, true self. Now we come across the second part of it. Is there a second form of the sound which is more accessible to us? Can we see the sound with our eyes? Yes, we can. The sound is manifested in a human form, in the form of a perfect living master. The perfect living master looks like a human being and a visual thing, and we can talk and get make friendship and get guidance from a person. But later on, when we put our attention inside and discover that reflection that we saw human being outside was actually a reflection of our own sound, that the sound has become personified as a human being. It is mentioned that it is the Word made flesh. It is the manifestation of the sound as a perfect living master outside. Imagine if this world is merely illusion, maya, mithya, unreal. The master must also be unreal if he's just outside in this experience of the maya. How can reality exist outside in one little part and the rest is all illusion? The master is part of illusion that you see outside. Because reality of that master is inside. And the closer you go to the reality of the master, why he's being seen outside, the more you discover the master is nothing more than the manifestation outside of the same sound. So it helps us to see the same sound, same power in a human form. And when you go within with your attention inside, you see that was just a reflection of the real form of the master, which was itself the same sound and the same word. It's not only one leap into going from external form of a physical human being as a master and seeing that inside. It's also step by step. First, you see the same master inside in a human form. Little more radiant, little more visible, more lighted up. Like everything else is lighted up when you see in the astral plane. You see the same form of the master. You say, there's a master outside, there's a master inside. One step. Then you discover the master is a friend of yours inside, companion. Then you find master is the same as the sound. Then you find at the end, you and the master are the same. What a great thing that our self, our totality of our own self, has generated an experience for great adventure in so many levels of consciousness, and then made an arrangement to go back to true home whenever we like, through the same sound, which is continuous, unbroken, and has an expression outside that we can see in the form of a living human being. Everything that we are seeing outside is also inside. Nothing exists outside in our experience that is not first generated inside. The whole world that we see outside is also inside. And you should know that inside and outside are virtually the same. When we pull our attention, we see the originals of which the replica, the reflection, we see outside. All people, all things, all experiences that we are having outside are also inside. And when you see the original of them, then you discover it's merely a reflection that we see through the aid of this strange sense of perception, that we create sense perceptions and put the inside out. We create space and time so that we can experience it in a different way. The totality of creation is an instant. It has been expanded. You go to the causal plane, you will see very strange things, that your destiny was made in one instant. And then you spread it over an artificial time and space, and put it in space and time, and put your events of your life on different places on the timeline that you created. And then you're moving on that timeline. It looks now like time is flowing. Actually, time is absolutely stationary. We are moving on time. Some people said that Egyptians had a great art of time travel. And I said, we all have that art. We are all traveling on time right now. Are we not moving from minute to minute? Are we not moving from one event to another? If this is not time travel, what is? Time is steady. It has all the events lined up already on it. And we are traveling from one event to another. It's a certain fixed pace of time travel. We can't change the pace. And that is why it looks like time is moving and we are not moving. But actually, we are moving on time from one event to another event and so on. That's how we spread it out. The single unit of creation in which all destiny was packed at once has been spread out into past, present and future. Now, a simple method of looking at past, present and future. Are they real? Look very real. We remember what happened yesterday. It was past. We are still planning what we'll do tomorrow. It's future. Looks very real. But think of it. When do we experience the past? By remembering that yesterday something happened. At what time are we experiencing this, that there was a past? Only now. One word, important word, now. We are experiencing the past now. And what are we experiencing the present? Now. How do we experience the future? By simple method of hoping for things, fearing things, anticipating things. Supposing from the languages of all the world, we delete these three words. Hoping, fearing, and anticipating, which are the same thing. It's anticipating is neutral, hoping is positive, fearing is negative. Supposing we delete these words from the dictionary, do you know there will be no future left? Nobody will talk of future. Future will be created by these. And when do we hope? When do we fear? When do we anticipate? In the now. Are we not living in the now? Somebody gave me a book saying, live in the now. I said, where else are we living? Has anybody lived in any other time except now? It's always now. We never live in any other part. But we create it. And now the most amazing thing is that now has no time. Not even a billionth part of a nanosecond. So we are living in a timeless state right now. Looks like we're having a lot of time. See the structure of this illusion. How beautifully placed it is. That we are living in a timeless now. All experiences of the past, present and future are taking place in now, and now has no time. And yet we believe we are passing through time. This is the greatest illusion. The greatest illusion we could have created to have these experiences was the illusion of time and space. And these are generated at the causal plane. When you withdraw your attention and go there, you see how events created now with no time are being spread out to create a destiny to be played out in other planes like the astral and the physical plane. You can see your own destiny. And then you will say, how come we different people here that we see here have different destinies? Because we had a choice. We picked up our own destiny. It is like going to a store to say, I like this DVD, I want to pick up this one, or I like another one. You pick up and play it out. We picked up our DVDs at the causal plane, what they call the Akashic records, the records in the Akash, and the sky, they're lying all in the sky of the causal plane. There's an orange colored sky with all the destinies stacked there, and we picked up a destiny, let's try this out. That's how we created our life here. Now the amazing thing is that we created by picking out a DVD, we created the law of karma. There was no karma at all. The soul has never had any karma, neither before nor after, nor now. Soul has no karma at all. The mind creates the karma when we pick up a DVD from the causal plane and bring it here to play it out. Now, let's put it in a context that there is some real time and we are coming from our true home with no karma. Soul is coming and for adventure says, okay, let me try out a new lifestyle. Let me see what kind of life I can lead, and comes and finds a large number of variety of packed lives and it picks up one and brings up and comes to the astral plane and from there comes to physical plane and is born here. It has had no previous life. Cannot have karma, but you can't have a life without karma. Therefore, the DVD contains not only the life which you enter, but its previous life from where it's created. Not only previous life, another life to create the previous life. So how many lives? Infinite. We create infinity in 1 second. And then It must lead to effect to future lives. How many? Infinite. What an amazing kind of experience to pick up your destiny in the form of a DVD from the causal plane and then come and play it out and immediately create all past lives and all future lives and get jammed into a law of karma and get trapped into it. We didn't come just to get really trapped into past lives, karma, now future lives, now sin, now virtue, now this, now good, now bad. We didn't come for that at all. We just came to play it out. How it is to have an experience of that. And by taking this as our only reality, we got trapped into it. Now, is there a past life? One can say no, because before you came in, there was no past life. You came in and created a past life. You didn't create a past life because there was a past life. You created past life because you had the experience of karma in now, which made it look like a past life. People say, is there a past life? I can say yes and I can say no, whichever way I like. I can tell them that if the soul has no karma and no past life, it comes first time, how can it have a past life? And I can also say, you can't have a life here unless there is a past life. So it's a package that we pick up. And it's a package that creates the whole universe and the law of karma as if we have to go from one lifetime to another. But then there is a little problem here. If we come in one lifetime and we notionally have past lives and then we act in this one life, we create real future lives. And then it becomes a real past life. Supposing we came a million years earlier to this experience with no past life, and then we kept on thinking we have a past life and work on it, we have by now created many real past lives. And therefore now it has become a reality. At that time it wasn't a reality when we started. So these things, if you want to see the source of how destiny is created, that's the point to go into. And you can all go. It's not something reserved for some people. I must tell you, the spiritual path is open to all human beings. It's a natural gift given to us. It's a gift placed inside us. It's a gift placed in consciousness in a living human physical body. And we can all have access to it. Therefore, when you see the nature of this, how the experience is being generated, you are left speechless. How can you describe this to anybody when you see what's going on? And who is anybody? Part of your DVD? Is there anybody at all? You created everybody. You create the whole characters. They are like puppets. But you made them living. Do you know how easy it is to make a puppet into a real living thing? I saw a puppet show the other day. And the man was talking to the puppet like it's a real thing. And he was telling the puppet said, I am going to sing a song in French. And the man said, you can't sing a song in French because I don't know French. He said, who cares whether you know it or not? The puppet says, I am going to sing in French. He said, look, the puppeteer says, I am a puppeteer. You are just a puppet. You can only speak that which I know. He said, if that were true, why are you arguing with me? The puppet says. And I mean, amazing. A puppeteer in Europe committed suicide because the puppet did not love him enough. If we can make a puppet into so much life, just a doll, look how little children play with dolls. They make them real. They'll miss other things, but not miss their dolls. It's the same thing. We have created so many dolls, such wonderful dolls, who are looking exactly like us, who look all alive like us, and we are leading this life, thinking they're all separate. They have to be separate to create drama. They have to be separate to create a life. So when you see the reality of these things, it is such an eye-opener. It is such a remarkable thing you see how this whole structure is built up. Totally changes your opinion about creation and about everything that is around you. And you begin to look at everything as part of yourself. Today we say, oh, you should love everybody. How can you love everybody when that is not your role in the play you picked up? You picked up a play, you hate this person, you like this person, you fall in love with him, you get disappointed with that one. If the play is like that, how can you say you love everybody? It's not intended to be like that. But when you discover that's all part of yourself, you automatically love even the show. The beauty of this show is that although it's a puppet show, you have created the characters. The characters are all placed on the stage. And you, the real self, have placed yourself in one character. And therefore you are watching the show not from an audience outside, but from within one character. And you begin to believe that's yourself. And that character then moves and looks at everything around and says, I'm just one of so many. I'm just like that. I'm as mortal, as temporary as everybody else. Because you put yourself in one character. Now people say, give us a shortcut to make life better. I give them a simple shortcut. Start taking life as a play. Think it's a big show, play going on. You are a character in it. All others are characters and all are doing according to their script. They are doing their part and reading exactly. They memorize their scripts and are performing their part. And think that you, the physical body, is one of the characters and you are sitting, watching this from behind the eyes inside. Then watch the show. Watch life as if you are watching it from inside. You've got a relaxed chair there and you are relaxing and watching all the characters, including yourself, acting. Your life will change in one day. If you are able to do just this, just little adjustment of viewing life, you'll see that life becomes totally different. But when you take it seriously, this is real, you get trapped into it. So when we pull our attention in meditation and discover the truth, discover what is actually real, it changes our attitude and life towards everything. What looks so bad suddenly becomes interesting and amusing. Of course, one can say, was it necessary to create so much pain and suffering in order to have an exciting drama? Couldn't we have a slightly better script and a better... we must have been very poor judges of what is a good play, that if we wrote up such a play and we are living that. The answer is, no, it doesn't matter what you wrote. It was a written play played out. It was not real. Supposing you have a bad dream. Supposing you have a nightmare at night. And you wake up in the morning and you say, that was a terrible dream. Thank God it was a dream. That's exactly what we say. No matter what we have experienced, we say, thank God it was an illusion. We created it and we are awake now. When you wake up, then the reality is different from what you experience in a dream state or an illusion. So that is why it didn't matter at all. But to make the drama more intense, you created extreme pairs of opposites. The pairs of opposites is what makes the drama extreme. If there were no opposites, we would have no drama. Everything we are experiencing in this physical show or the astral show is based upon pairs of opposites. You can't experience anything if there's no opposite of it. Take the example of light, for example. We are sitting in a hall with light. Supposing this light was always there, whether we open our eyes or close our eyes, and the light is always visible, we would never have seen it. If there was no darkness, there would have been no such thing as light. It's the darkness that created light, and light that created darkness. If we were all happy all the time, we'd never be happy. It's only when we are unhappy, we're able to see that we can be happy. The whole concept, experience of happiness, does not come by itself. It comes when there is something opposite to compare it with. Similarly, if you look at all the experiences we have in the physical world, in the astral world, in the heavens, they're all based upon pairs of opposites. You can't have a heaven if you can't have a hell. You can't have extreme pain. If you don't have extreme pleasure, you can't have moderate pain if you can't have moderate pleasure, and so on. Everything is balanced on pairs of opposites. That's why we call it a world of duality. This is the dual nature of the world. It has to be placed in pairs of opposites. And yet our true home is beyond pairs of opposites. Then how do we experience our true home? If every experience that consciousness needs requires an opposite, then how can we be enjoying our own true home where there is no pairs of opposites at all? Simple. We created a world of duality, and the non-duality becomes a pair of opposite, which means this kind of creation was necessary for us even to appreciate our true home. Something people miss out. They ask the fundamental question, what's the purpose of this life? What's the purpose of this creation? It's a simple purpose, that if this opposite of non-duality was not there, if duality was not an opposite of non-duality, we would never have experienced non-duality either. We would not even experience Satchkhand if nothing existed beyond Satchkhand. So if we forget this, that there's a whole method in this madness of creation, that the whole thing, including that which has no pairs of opposites, had to be experienced by creating an artificial world, artificial creation of opposites. So everything here is based upon that. And the law of karma, which now governs our life after life over here in the physical world and in the astral world, this law of karma has been so designed, it's not operated by anything physical, anything sensory, anything astral, only by the mind. The law of karma is operated by the mind, created in the mind, operated in the mind, paid off by the mind, whole system works in the mind. What action you do here is not governed by law of karma. What your mind is behind that action, the intention behind that action, creates karma. And the karma is of three kinds. You must have heard about it, that the karma is that which makes you get born here, a past life karma without which you can't take birth here. What parents you pick up, where you are born, what location you are born, what environment you are born, all that is based upon past karma. So therefore, there has to be some carryover from previous karma to create a life here. What we carry over from there, we call it pralabdh. We call it our destiny, our fate. We have been born with it. We have no control over it. We had control in the past, maybe, but not now. Now we are born with a destiny, with the pralabdh, based upon past karma, and we have to go through it, no matter what. Because all the events of our past life coming as our pralabdh, as our destiny in this life, are already fixed. Where we'll be born, where we will die, what accidents we will have, who we will meet, what interaction we'll have, where we'll get disappointed, where we'll feel happy, where we will laugh, all fixed already. This is our destiny. But then in the destiny are left little gaps of very strange kind of experience we called karman karma, where we make new decisions. That is different. About 70 to 80% of our life is pralabdh. 70 to 80% of all our life is totally fixed beforehand. And we have no control. Even while we are sitting here, we know we have no control over those things. A man is born in a certain city, he can't say, I could have been born somewhere else. No choice. His death takes place, he couldn't have determined where it will take place. Similarly, so many events over which you had no determination, which you never thought of. But there are those little gaps when the mind begins to say, should I do this or that? Is this a right way or that right way? That's the only time when you create new karma. All the rest is old karma. Nothing to do about it. You have just to pay off. Get rewarded for good deeds, get punished for bad deeds, and that's it. Then you come into these little areas where you create new karma. And every new karma requires that you first feel there are more than one option, that you could do this or that. If you don't have an option, it's not a new karma. New karma is only created when you know there is more than one option and you consider and deliberate and say this or that, then decide this. That's karma. That's how we make new karma. The new karma immediately has an implication and the result, which can be good or bad. What makes good or bad? Our mind has a certain section called conscience. It's the moral side of the mind. It creates good and bad. And the conscience sitting inside our mind, in the thinking mind, when we do something, says, that was good. It's a commentator. Says, that was a good thing. How is it determined? Not by its own volition, but by the rest of the karmic connection with society, with other people. The society in which you're growing up sets up the standards of your morality. And they say, today this is good, this is bad. After 100 years, they're all different. Every time, every society, every different country has different morality. Your conscience is accustomed to use the morality where you are born and where you live. So your conscience says, this is good, you are rewarded for that. Your conscience says, I shouldn't have done it, it's not good, you're punished for it. All system is built into the mind. The mind then functions to create the karma, and then you have to go through an experience of punishment and reward. And so you set the seed, you have sown the seeds of future events right in the same place in the physical world. But then our mind is very active. Sometimes we have a thought and we never act upon it. We just have intention, I want to kill that person. But we never kill him. Karma is still created because of the intention and gets registered. And then we say, I shouldn't have even thought like that. That makes it even worse. That means you realize it was a bad karma. So you have predetermined your punishment for that in future. So when karma works like this, you create so much karma in one lifetime. In one lifetime, a human being can create so much karma, it may require 1 million lives to pay off. So how can you make one life after one life from the karma of a previous life? You only pick up a few items and make a life. What happens to the rest of the karma? It goes into a reservoir, which we call the sinchit karma. So that's how we divide between the prarabdha, the karma, and the sinchit, the reserve karma. It goes into a huge reserve. And the reserve is the trap, real trap. Because supposing you decide through wise guidance to live a karma-less life, and I'll talk about it. If you want to have a karma-less life, you've stored enough karma to make several lives out of the reserve only. How do we live a karma-less life? Don't deliberate and make choices. What we used to call go with the flow. Whatever circumstances come, just go with it. Make no decisions. Let circumstances make decisions. Let other people make decisions. You don't make a decision. And once that happens, you go with that, you're creating very little karma. But sinchit is there. The reserve is there to create another life for you. It's a very big trap. We have created a spider's web that has no limit. And we get traveled and we keep on traveling from lifetime to lifetime in that. And we came just for one life to have a good time and see what it looks like, what the experience would be like, and go back home. And we are trapped here for endless time. That's our state. And when you go through meditation and go above to the causal region and see your own Akashic records and how you picked up this, then you discover that there is no way out except to transcend the whole system, to go beyond the system, which means go beyond the mind. If you want to leave all this karma behind and not wait for good deeds to undo the bad deeds and not wait for karma to settle the karma, then you have to go above the system itself. Which means, since the whole karma is set up in the mind, go above the mind. The true spiritual path, according to me, is when you discover you are a spirit, you are a soul, and you want to reach your own origin, the totality. When the Atma can find its own identity and say, am I part of Paramatma, and becomes the Paramatma. That is the spiritual path. The rest is a preparation for going to that stage. So we are preparing here to reach that point from where we can go above. But there are very few people, very few human beings. According to my master, even in Kali Yuga, even the Iron Age we are living now, there are not more than a few people, few human beings who have the awareness of their totality. And they can be counted on your fingers or the two hands. So that's almost the limit, even at this time. In earlier ages, you could hardly find one, two, where they were great seekers. Where do these people appear? Where do these human beings appear on this planet? They appear where there are seekers who want to seek beyond the mind. Those who are seeking good results, those who are seeking wish fulfillment of getting their wishes fulfilled in this world, those who want to go to heaven, they can find many other teachers, many other masters. But those who are fed up with the whole law of karma and want to go beyond their minds, it is there that these masters appear, and they come in response to us, the seekers. We seek, and then they come and appear. We can't find them. There's no way you can ever find a perfect living master with your own effort, because he's too ordinary. He never says he's a master. Does not show off. Pretends to be a totally ordinary person, and comes into our life as an ordinary person and affects us by his unconditional love, and we gradually begin to understand what's going on. So how can you find such a person? But the person who's like that with that awareness can find us. If we are a seeker, we are seeking inside for going beyond the mind, and a perfect living master cannot come, he's not a master then at all. If he cannot come into our life at the right time when we are seeking, how could he be, how is he able to help us? So therefore, though we cannot find a master can find us. So the secret, if I may say, the secret of finding a perfect living master of that kind is to seek within yourself. Seek earnestly and ask for it, pray for it with passion. I want it. No need to open your mouth and shout about it. Shout inside. Shout inside, he'll appear in your life by coincidence, by circumstances, by strange kind of coincidences. You'll wonder how this happened. Sometimes it'll be such a strange coincidence, it'll be quite different from your own search. That your search was in one direction, it turned up from somewhere else. So these are the amazing experiences we have, because such a perfect living master works from a level of awareness where he knows us. And he knows we are part of the same one. And that is why this kind of drama of a perfect living master coming into our life comes up. I remember somebody recommended to me to see a movie called Inception. I don't know if any of you have seen that movie, Inception. In that movie, they show that you can go into a dream state and have a different kind of dream and not connected with what is happening in your wakeful life. And then you can dream within a dream and have an even different experience. And then you can go have a dream within a dream, within a dream, third dream, and totally different experience. I like that movie for two or three reasons. One was, in that movie they mentioned that a 10-minute of dream can create the first dream in which you live an hour or two. That means the time frame is different. You can expand time by going into a dream state. And when you go from dream to another dream, the 1 hour of first dream creates a whole lifetime of 50 years in the third dream. So that is beautiful, because that's exactly how our dream state has come about. From zero time, we are not in the third dream, in the sixth dream. In the sixth dream, we have created the whole permanent space and time of this universe. The second good reason I liked that was that every person who goes into the dream wants to make sure he can wake up and carries a totem in his hand. A little piece that can pierce the hand, and the pain of it wakes you up. And that's exactly what happens here. That when you feel you are fed up and want to rise to a wakefulness from here, from this physical state of experience, you feel the pain, and the totem is the perfect living master who appears in your life and wakens you up. So there's a lot of similarity I saw, and therefore I like that movie. I don't normally see many movies, but somebody recommended, I saw. So you will notice that the time frame is so different. They did some experiments on sleeping and dreaming in the United States. In the 60s, when I first went there, I attended some of those seminars on studying dreams and sleep. And there I found that a person can have a short dream of 7-8 minutes and live a whole life in it. Not only 1 hour, not 2 hours. A person who actually, a subject, saw he was born somewhere, little child growing up, going to school, He got studied, got a graduation, got married, had children, became grandfather and died all in 7 minutes stream. The actual experience was of a whole lifetime. But when they measured it, the actual time, and how were they doing? They placed electrodes and all that on the body, and they were watching, cameras were watching the eye movement, the rapid eye movement, and they found out when the rapid eye movement is there, the person is dreaming. They'd wake up in the middle and ask the person, what are you seeing? And they'll describe the middle of the dream. And then they go to sleep again. In the morning when they wake up, they say, we had no dream at all. Then they play the audio tapes that you told us these things while you were sleeping. 99% of our dreams, we forget on waking up. So we never know we dream. But we all dream every night. It's a necessity for us to dream. It's a necessity. It's an emotional catharsis for us to dream. Without that, we'll be so tensed up, so stressed up, we wouldn't be able to live in this world. So dreaming is a great art of relieving our tensions and relieving our excess of emotions. And same thing happens when we go to see a movie. A dream is like going to see a movie. And this dream we are having is also like to go to see a movie. From our true home, we came to see a movie. We are taking the movie so seriously because we became part of the character in the movie. So that's how you got trapped here. When you go to see a movie, you know it's unreal. You know the only people acting. You also know there is nobody on the screen. It's just a shadow. There's no person there. And you watch, and you're sitting on the edge of your chair in the audience, and something happens, you get tears in your eyes, and you scream at some scenes. They're unreal. Yet you take them as real. Nobody's ever cared to sit in his movie hall and look back that this is merely a pre-programmed film shot much earlier, packed into a projector, and the light behind the projector is casting shadows in front of you. And not only that, it's a still pictures moving rapidly, creating movement on the screen. Have you ever noticed that? We take it all seriously. People are moving, things are happening. Now what will happen next? We sit wondering, what will happen next? As if many things can happen. What is going to happen will happen. It reminds me of a villager in India who first time came to see a movie, an Indian movie, in which by chance there was a scene where a girl takes off her clothes and takes a dip into the water. But before he can see the nude girl, a train comes in front, and by the time the train goes, the girl is already in the water. That boy went 20 times to see the movie, hoping that one day the train will be late. Do you know that's how we live our life here? And no difference. We are in the same state. We are constantly thinking things will be different. They are never different. But we don't see it like that. So when we go to see a movie, why do we cry and laugh at a movie? Why do we take it so seriously? The reason is, it was explained by a Greek philosopher, Aristotle. Aristotle explained the importance of drama. There were no movies in those days, but drama was there on the stage. He explained the importance of drama in our life because he said, when you see drama and see the characters, you identify yourself with those characters. You begin to see as if it is your life. Although they are acting, but you are not acting. You are being affected by the drama because you take it that this is like me, this is like me. What happens, according to Aristotle, the value of a drama is it leads to a purgation of the excess of emotions. He called that a purgation of excess of emotions, and that's how it makes you sane and normal. The drama is so essential, according to him. And then he says that why do we then take the drama as real? He said, to translate his exact phrase from Greek, he says, it's a willing suspension of disbelief. We would normally not believe, but we willingly at that time suspend our disbelief. So for the sake of removing the excess of our emotions. That is true of all drama. That is true of this drama we call life. From our true state, where we are in the causal plane, this show that we set up here in the physical world is to remove the excess of our strain of emotions that is built into us, into our personality. Consciousness has the power that creates experiences, has created all kinds of experiences possible. It has created worlds after worlds. It has created so many different universes. It has created different levels of consciousness, all for the purpose of exploring the possibilities of what you can be conscious of. It's unlimited. And this is just an experiment. This is one of the experiments that we are doing right now. So it's not something that is the only one. When you go within, you will have a chance to go and see other universes. That is such a great voyage, according to me. People want to see what's happening in the other galaxies, are there other worlds? Very difficult to travel in this kind of space-time here. People are trying very hard to warp the space and do some, bend the time and join it together and do various kinds of things. We are very, very far off from that, if scientifically it is possible. But within, at the astral plane, you can have access to travel this universe and other universes. This universe, because the what I call the astral plane. Astral plane is when you become unaware of this body and your other body opens up, it can still see the universe. It can see this universe also. It can see another universe also. The two universes are overlapping. Not all, completely, part of it. This universe, the physical universe, in its entirety, is like a globe. It's because you can go in every direction. Supposing there is an object in which from the center you can go in every direction equidistant, it will become like a balloon, it will become like a globe. This universe in which we are living here, in every direction, is infinite. Therefore, it's like a globe. If infinity we count as a number, then this is a sphere. We are living in a sphere. Einsteinian theory said that we have bent space to a point which is completely bent and also become a sphere. So whichever way you take it, it's a sphere. The astral world is also a sphere. And only part of it overlaps the sphere. So when the overlap takes place, one sphere places on another sphere of experience, in the middle, a fish-like area occurs. And this fish-like area is where the overlap experience can take place, that you can be in this world and also in the other. When people die, they are in the overlap. And so many times we say, the spirit of the dead person is still here, moving around. And that is true. Because immediately after death, we are so connected with this world, we don't run away somewhere else. We're still trying to find solace, find connection right here. Therefore, even in disembodied state, in the astral state, we still roam around here in the astral body, and that is all in the overlap stage. We call such spirits ghosts, spirits. In India, we use two words for them, bhoot, pret. The distinction between bhoot and pret is that bhoot we call those spirits which are hovering around looking for something they couldn't find. They roam around, they fly all over. First time they find, they can fly easily, which they could not do in their human bodies. And they roam around the skies, they go to different places, and those are the bhoots. The pret is tied up to one place because of the event, like a murder, like a suicide, like an unnatural death, and they stick to the same place. So mostly they are in this kind, this category. Some, of course, are they move around at their will, what they've determined before they died. People, when they die, they have certain wishes and desires, and they get unfulfilled, and they can also be fulfilled in the astral overlap space. So you can sometimes have access to them. They can see us, we can't see them, except if you open the inner eye, then you can see them. If you open your inner eye, you can see all the spirits around. Sometimes people wonder, when I'm giving a talk, how many others are attending also, whom we can't see. Some people we can see. Some people sitting in my audience can also see. Some people who are physically dead. But I am only mentioning the overlap stage because of the sphere, spherical nature. of this created universe, the physical universe in space and time, is spherical. So is the astral world also spherical and much larger. So the overlap is a small piece like a fish shape. The astral world is also then overlapping the causal world, where time and space is created. That's another bigger sphere. So the big sphere is a smaller sphere and a third sphere, and two overlaps. They look like two fish. I read that Jesus Christ fed two fish to 5,000 people or 50,000 people. The number is varying according to accounts. But people are really thinking that he caught the fish out of the pond and cut them into pieces to serve them. People have no idea he was talking of these two fish, of inner experiences. When he said he served two fish to so many people, he's talking of an inner experience, of how these experiences of the physical and astral, and causal, overlap each other, and how you can have these experiences by going within. When he talked of the kingdom within us, he talked of these areas and described them like this. We twisted it around to mean they were real fish he caught up and served to people. But the fish-like structures can be visited, and the first fish-like structure, which is between the causal and between the astral and the physical, there we can meet people who have died recently, unless they have gone beyond. And therefore people ask me, can we meet a person who died? I said, of course, if there is that overlap. Most of them are in the overlap. They'll come back from there only into next birth. Those who don't come back into the birth, they move up. In the causal and astral overlap, it's a very interesting area. It's almost like they bend down into the form of a tunnel, a lighted tunnel. It's not exactly the same shape like this. If we can use the example of a space, it is referred to as a crooked tunnel. In the literature, they refer to that overlap, second overlap, as a crooked tunnel or bunk naal. The bunk naal is really a state where you can have access to both sides. If you move from there below, you come back to astral. If you move up, you go to causal. From there, you have access to both sides. So it's a very important stage in your spiritual experience when you meditate and go to that state. And there are many souls enjoying that state of the bunk naal. Of course, above that, the whole creation ends as we know it. The three worlds end there. The causal plane is the end, the top. After that, there's no space, no time. And there's no mind, and there's no thinking. None of this stuff is there. Only the pure soul discovers itself, that it was the cause, it was the empowerment, it was the life force that made all this possible. That's our true nature. Our true nature is that we are unit of consciousness per se. There's nothing added on to it. And we add on these things to make a conscious experience. The word consciousness that we use for that state implies that we are conscious of something. You can't say consciousness and there's nothing to be conscious of. You can't use that word. And we have no word to describe what it would be like if we are nothing conscious of. But the way we look at it is that consciousness creates this universe on a permanent basis to remain consciousness. Therefore, our true state, our true home is also permanent, immortal, forever, and the world that's being created is also permanent, except that the world is constantly changing and that does not change. That's the main difference, which is again a pair of opposites, a changing experience and a non-changing experience in total consciousness. We have the ability in human body to reach the highest level. We are all equipped with it. Isn't it amazing? We can get out of this mess, if we call it a mess. Or we can stay here, have a glimpse of all those things, and enjoy this life also, like a movie. We have so many options open to us just by having an inner, higher experience of consciousness. So I have come to share this with you, so that you can at least have a peep in, have a glimpse. What else is there? Then make your own judgment what you want to do about it. Shall we try a little bit now? You all said, many of you raised your hand yesterday, that you would like to actually meditate. If you are ready now, we'll start. How many of you could actually do this? How many of you enjoyed this? How many of you felt it was very boring? What are we trying to do? Apparently, most of you seem to have enjoyed it. Isn't it wonderful if meditation was always enjoyable? And not that it's a boredom, we have been asked to do it, and therefore we are doing it. On the other hand, you are interested, it is interesting, you are interested in it, and you are doing it, and you get joy out of it. So what you did very briefly today, how many of you got joy out of it? I'm so very happy to see that. It was a good short session. These are introductions only to what we can do and how we should do it. Remember that the most important thing is not to move away from there. Visions will come, sights will come, but they will not come if you go after them. They will come if you stay back in the center. They are arising by your staying as close to the center as possible. When you stay behind the eyes at the center, all these things start coming up there. Once you becoming unaware of the body, then you can fly anywhere you like. So, tomorrow we'll fly. How many of you are coming tomorrow? Okay, we'll fly tomorrow. All right? We'll have a break for lunch. Enjoy your lunch. And I'll come back in the afternoon and see you again.